Let's hear another one, huh? Why not? That was when Mick Jagger was a street fighting man kind of guy now, you know what I mean? Then he turned kind of chic on us a little bit later, you know? That's when he was a heavy rock and roller. All right, we have just been accepted by Facebook Live, so we're going to go live to Dr. Sean Kondamuri of Midwest Interventional Spine. How you doing, doctor?
Doing great, Jim. How are you? Doing fantastic.
We miss you.
Yeah, I think Memorial Day got in the way there, and it kind of messed up our last broadcast.
That and a little COVID-19 and some, the economy, and then of course some protesting kind of took a little bit of my time. But other than that, we're back in the game, man. I hear you went to a conference, right?
I did actually. Yes, I just went to a conference called it's a device called the Intracept. Device, new technology for treating previously less recognized cause of low back pain. So I'm pretty excited about it because I think we can really help some patients by offering them this very minimally invasive surgery to help take away back pain that we never really thought about before. It's just another weapon in my armamentarium to attack, you know, low back pain.
Talking to Dr. Kondamuri, he is a doctor. If you could just give us, it's been a while, so if you don't mind reminding people who you are, this show is sponsored by Midwest Spine, so go ahead.
My name is Sean Kondamuri. I'm an interventional spine specialist, and we treat a lot of low back pain. I'm in practice in Munster, Indiana. That's our main office. We have a few other offices as well in the region. My partners are Dr. Dasari, Dr. Gupta, Dr. Kondamuri. We have a couple of wonderful nurse practitioners. Rita, Katie, and Lisa, and we all work together to help people with chronic pain in our region.
How do they feel about you being a media star?
I don't think I'm a media star. I'm just answering your questions. We're having a little conversation. That's all.
There's a lot going on. And I didn't realize this when we started this, but Dr. Kondamuri is big wellness. I guess a wellness doc. In his own way, and just kind of pays a lot of attention. But doctor, I got to start right with this. You know, we started talking a couple of months ago when the coronavirus lockdown, we were in the middle of it. We went through some possible ways to deal with being locked down. And we're talking about all the stress. But since then, I mean, that seemed like child's play to what's going on right now in the world. I mean, you got to give us something about how to deal with this stuff physically.
You know, I mean, stress is very stress, mental stress of any kind of stress, financial stress, mental stress, emotional stress. The stress we're dealing now with COVID-19, with the the protesting, peaceful protesting, and the additional more. Unpeaceful things that are going on are very stressful for a lot of people, especially when businesses are at stake and people are struggling with their finances. So, I mean, you really have to know that affects your body. And when you have stress affecting your body, your body responds. It responds negatively. And, all of your medical conditions that you might have, whether it's hypertension or heart disease, they all become impacted. You know, it affects your nervous system. So we really need to try our best to calm down. We really need to try our best to find a way to deal with that stress. First, identify it. And, simple things like just, kind of be conscious of your breathing, for example. I mean, you want to sit down every now and then, sit down in a chair or in a couch or on the ground and just sort of focus on relaxing yourself. And I think there's a lot to be said about just managing your breath, focusing on your breath, concentrating on your breath, concentrating on how your body feels. And really, you really can slow down your heart rate, and you can slow down, you can calm down a lot of those hormones that are in your body that are stressing you out. It comes with training. It's just like meditation. I mean, you have to really be doing this a lot, and you get calmer and calmer.
You guys want to talk to Kondamuri if you want it, Dr. Kondamuri, and if you want any, questions about this or any comments, or you have your own suggestions about what you're doing during this time. Let us know, man, because we're all ears right now, and so are all the listeners and viewers. You know, doctor, you know, you talked about that, about, you know, I got really upset on the show this morning at a caller, and I never really do. I don't ever really get, it's one guy can kind of get under my skin, and I let it happen today. And I realized that I was already kind of at a heightened level, but I had another guy just text me. He said, it's pretty easy. Let me see if I could get this. Here it is. He said, in through your nose, out through your mouth for at least 30 seconds every hour.
Yes.
And it makes a big difference. And I just can never do that. I mean, it's just like all right, concentrate on your breathing. I'm like, oh, geez, that sounds like another thing to have to do. But once you do it, you can usually bring yourself back to center. So I guess it's just a mindfulness.
It is, Jim, and it is. It's really hard when you start. But I was the same way. I never meditated at all, and I don't even really call what I do now meditation. But what we are doing is something that takes a little bit of practice, and you really can, you can change a lot. I mean, you can change your mood, like you said. It has a lot to do with mindfulness, but you really can bring yourself to a better state. I mean, there's a lot to be said. A lot of people talk about, you know, trying to put yourself into the right state of mind. It's all about mindset and really get yourself into a beautiful state. And, you know, everybody knows when you're in a good mood and you start your day off well, your day goes well. If you are in a crummy mood and you're kind of upset about something, well, guess what? Everything just sort of goes downhill from there. So you really have to consciously put yourself into a good state of mind. And it's harder to do than it is to say, because I struggle the same way. We have all our stresses. You know, if you have children, it's hard. You know, every now and then you're going to get mad at your kid or whatever. They're not going to really do what you want them to do. And you get stressed out. I mean, it happens to all of us. And it is something that all of us can improve upon. We all figure it out when we get older and older.
Yeah, well, good. Yeah, you're supposed to get wiser as you get older. And Hey, doctor, now, when we talked for a while there when we were doing this, You weren't seeing patients in the office, and then you started to. Where's the practice at right now?
You know, we're probably now almost, I would call it like 70 or 80% of where we were. It's picked up a lot. I mean, we are now seeing patients in the office. We're not doing as many televisits anymore. We still do some televisits or video visits for patients who are really at high risk. But truly, I mean, the majority of patients are coming into the office now, and we're seeing them in person. But, you know, just like many of my colleagues, you know, we might schedule a patient, and a patient may want to come in on Thursday morning, let's say, and then come Wednesday night or Thursday morning, they're going to say, well, you know, maybe I'm not that bad. I don't want to take the risk of going out. So we still have a few people who are choosing to stay at home, and that's fine. You know, there's some people who are just calling in at the last minute and choosing to play it safe at home.
Now, when somebody comes in, what's the protocol now, and compare that to maybe pre-corona? I mean, like,
yeah, so
yeah, go ahead.
Great. Yeah. I mean, for every patient who walks into any doctor's office now, I'm pretty sure, or medical facility, I'm pretty sure they're going to have the temperature checked on their forehead. They've got to have a normal temperature, and they're going to be asked a few questions. In our office, we ask them the common questions about whether or not they've had a fever, whether or not anybody at home is sick, whether or not they have any shortness of breath or cough or headaches, you know, anything to indicate that they might have COVID-19. We want to really screen for that. And then when they come into the office, in anybody's office now, they're going to keep people apart. I mean, you even have in a lot of places, like in airports and hotels and restaurants, you have like X's on chairs, so you don't sit in that chair, which is a nice way to go. So you know you're sitting in a chair that puts you 6 feet away from the next person. So we're going to maintain all those sort of restrictions. And when it comes to medical facilities, we're not even allowing, for the most part, we're not allowing family members in. Family members are being asked to stay in their car unless the patient needs help to come in. Then you can bring them in. But otherwise, if the patient can ambulate or, you know, move on their own, please stay in the car. We'll call you when the patient's ready to go. And that's the same for any hospital, surgical center, or office practice. Whatever we can do to keep people safe, we're all wearing masks in the office when we're in front of patients, and we're wiping down everything all the time, you know, chairs and countertops and tables, everything is being wiped down with some virucidal and bactericidal wipes. And that's pretty common everywhere now. And I think what we've all done, what the government has asked us to do, has really helped. I mean, things are better than they could have been. It was, I remember one time we anticipated you know, 1.5 or 2 million deaths. We have far, far, far fewer than that. And I think overall we're heading in the right direction. Hopefully we won't have another resurgence of this disease.
Talking to Dr. Sean Kondamuri. And so doctor, in terms of, you know, it's weird that, like, I took my wife not too long ago to see my cousin, the foot doctor, right? And I was never a big fan of going there and just, like, sitting around waiting for my cousin, which I should never have to do. And we would wait, you know, significant amounts of time sometimes. And then this, when we go now, we go up, we pull up, and he moved into a new office. It's right on the street. And we wait in the car, and then they call us. We listen to music and chat, and then she goes in by herself and then comes back out. And I'm like, wow, that's really I like that. You know what I mean? You're not in and waiting and somebody else is sitting in my own car with the air conditioning on. I wonder if there will be any holdover of these methods once we get past this. You think so?
I think there will be. I think that's a great observation, Jim. I think there will be some holdover about, you know, with these methods. I think that people are going to be, at least for the foreseeable future and maybe out 5 years, 10 years, people are going to be a little more cautious. Just like in some Asian countries, they're very cautious about exposing themselves to other infections that people might have in the nearby vicinity. You're going to see some changes. I mean, telehealth has made so many strides in these last few months. I suspect that we're going to see more telehealth being used. Good or bad, I don't know if I entirely agree with it, because I really like to see a patient in person and examine them in person. You can't do all that via video, but some of it is going to hold over, and rightly so. I mean, there's efficiencies that come out of these things. Technology improves and allows us to do things better. It's going to be there.
Dr. Kondamuri is pain and a lot of other things, but he's in Munster, and if you want to talk to him, 219-845-1100 if you got any questions or comments. All right, we're coming out of this now. And, you know, a lot of people did not come to see you. They're like, all right, you know, we're just going to stand down. And maybe they're still kind of standing down as maybe we get into later June and stuff. They're going to come out. They're going to be shaken out of their houses. What kind of things that kind of built up over the last 2.5 months have you seen or do you expect to see?
Yeah, I mean, we're seeing it for sure, Jim. People are going backwards a little bit. I mean, I had patients who I saw in January, for example, or February, and we put them in physical therapy. That's an easy example. We put them in physical therapy. And for a long time, physical therapy was closed, so they couldn't get their therapy. And if they don't get the therapy, they're going to stiffen up, and their range of motion decreases, and they can't walk. All kinds of things happen. And then even when physical therapy opens up again, you know, I have patients that are telling me that they didn't want to go. They were worried about going and they were concerned, so they still didn't go. And I saw a patient, you know, just a couple of days ago. I was surprised that he wasn't in therapy. And he tells me that, you know, he was kind of embarrassed to say it, but he finally did admit that he just didn't go because he was worried. So that particular gentleman is set back a lot. I mean, it's going to take a while for him to come back to his baseline. And that leads to a lot of people who are going to develop flare-ups and aggravation of their injuries and their pain. And sadly, when during the time when we were not seeing patients and it was a lot of telehealth, we had to do some things that we didn't want to do. For example, we're very strict about using opioids. We don't like to use painkillers on patients unless it's a very severe problem. So we had to give patients, you know, we had to kind of hold them over with some low dose painkillers to let them manage. And, you know, people become dependent on these medicines pretty quickly. And we have a pretty big problem with opioids in this country. And, you know, we don't want to be part of that. So we really limit what we use. And we had to increase that a little bit over these last couple of months. So we're taking people back to where they belong now, taking them off their medicines and getting them the proper treatments that they need.
What do you got against opioids? I know that's a loaded question, but I just want to hear you say it, put it that way.
Yeah, well, opioids, without a doubt, cause problems. And opioids cause people get dependent on it. People get addicted to opioids. And they tell you, I mean, I can't tell you how many patients I have who tell me, you know, doctor, they don't do anything to me. It doesn't affect me one bit. And perhaps that's true for a small minority of patients, but the vast majority of patients, the reason they take their opioids is the same reason we tap onto social media and we look at, you know, Facebook or whatever. It literally releases dopamine, and that dopamine, you know, affects the pleasure centers in your brain, and you want more and more of those dopamine hits. So you take more and more opioids, and you take more and more, you do whatever you can to stimulate those centers in your brain. That's addiction. And people get addicted, and what happens is we have an opioid abuse problem. People become addicted, and they overdose on their medications, and sometimes they die. And we have had a lot of unnecessary deaths in America because of opioid abuse. And it's not really the prescription medications that are killing them. It used to be primarily the prescription medications that killed them, the Norcos and the Vicodins, and the oxycodone and the OxyContin. But now it's the people who are using some of these medications, and they go out and those they're really getting killed from fentanyl or carfentanil. These are agents that are mixed into the heroin that they're using now. And they're dying from that because they get a blast, a high dose of opioid that their body can't tolerate.
We're talking to Dr. Sean Kondamuri. You want to talk to him? Let's do it, huh? 219-845-1100. Hey, you're on with Doctor. What's going on?
Hey, Jim. It's me again.
Hi. How are you?
Good. Hi, Doctor.
Hi. How are you?
Pretty good. I just want to say I had a lumbar infusion in 2003.
Okay.
And I went through physical therapy, water therapy, and none of that worked. So then I went through, I don't know how many of the shots in my back. No, didn't help either. But then we lost our insurance, and the doctor I was seeing, every time I went in, he kept raising the price of the office visit, prices of the shots, and I finally told him, I said, I'm not paying for those shots. They're not working. And he kept insisting that I take them, so I quit going to him.
So you got a question there, Deb?
Yeah. Well, now we got insurance. And now the insurance we have only pay like 3 visits a year, so now I can't even go to a doctor.
Are you walking around with back pain?
They did that one thing where they zap your legs and stuff. I have chronic nerve damage in my sciatica.
All right, so you do have insurance though, right? But they're limiting your number of visits, correct?
Yeah, and to get medications, they always said I had to come in like every month.
Okay. All right. Well, we're going to address that. Anything else you want to know out of this case, doctor, before we analyze it?
Yeah, I would actually just encourage Deborah to still see the doctor. I mean, we doctors have to deal with insurance issues all the time, and those insurance companies make it very difficult to provide good care. But we still work around that somehow. We figure out how to make it work and hopefully get you feeling better without a lot of painkillers. The idea is to really figure out ways to improve your health. That's why I like to talk a lot about, you know, health and wellness, because it's not all about injections or surgeries or pills. You have to figure out other ways to get better. And that might be through exercise or weight loss or, you know, increasing your flexibility. It depends. Everybody's different, but we have to have these conversations.
Yeah. Okay. I also, too, had that thing put in my back, that stimulator.
Oh, wow. So you had a lot of things done then.
Yeah, and I got so mad about that. I had that surgery done, and they couldn't even get that thing going. I was so mad. I had them take it out, and then I had I switched doctors. They had like 4 or 5 doctors in that office, and they were trying to pressure me into doing it again, so I quit going there too.
Well, it sounds like we're going to talk about lower back pain. I kind of wanted to talk about that anyways. Thank you, Deb, for being so candid about your situation. Talk to you soon. See ya. 219-845-1100. Hey, you're on with Dr. Kondamuri.
Yeah, I have a question for Sean.
Hi, how are you doing, sir?
Hi, Sean. I used to go to you back in the 90s and early 2000s to get some shots for my L4 and L5, and I ended up getting Coflex implants.
Okay.
And it was like a miracle for me. But I recently was going down my stairs with somebody holding a desk, and he let go, and it hit me, and my L5S1 is screwed up now. Is there anything I could do besides cortisone?
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great, that's a common story. What's your name, sir?
No, Jamie. What, your first name?
Jamie.
All right, Jamie.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
So, Jamie, so what you and Deborah both described are problems that happen after a fusion. In your case, you had a Coflex implant, and you actually did really well for a long time. In Deborah's case, she had a fusion and didn't do well at all. And Deborah has something called a failed back surgery syndrome, meaning you have severe chronic pain after an appropriate surgery. And you have what sounds like a problem that happens after a surgery that helped you. And then there's wearing down of different parts of your body. For example, in your case, your Coflex is done at L4-5, which is a great surgery. And then now you have problems at L5-S1. And that we call it adjacent segment degeneration. So that means the level next to the level that you had your operation on is now wearing down. Now you might have a stenosis or an inflammation, and there are things you can do for that, non-surgical.
I know the doctor told me it was basically fusing itself. It was bone on bone.
Yeah, so that bone on bone is degeneration. That's wearing out.
So, but I'm diabetic, so prednisone and cortisone I can't take because it raises my sugar.
Yeah, that's a problem with being diabetic, but it doesn't mean you can't have it. You just have to get it very carefully. It has to be given to you very carefully, Jamie. I mean, you can get a steroid, but we have to monitor you very carefully if you do that. Or we have to look at options that are non-steroid options, and there are many non-steroid injection options for treating people who have degeneration or, you know, like a complete like bone-on-bone disease next to their surgery.
Mine was when I came to you, I had shots from different people all over the place, and yours were the only ones that actually worked.
I'm glad to hear that, Jamie.
Jamie, thanks a lot, man. You got a lot of background noise. Where are you at?
I'm in Munster.
You're driving or what?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thanks a lot.
Come back again, Jamie, and we'll take a look at it, and I'm sure we can calm that down for you.
All right. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Have a great day, Jamie.
Bye.
All right. You're going to have to re-explain that. So he had a problem in one part of the back. Where's L4, L5?
So hang on. I'll show you.
All right. So you got the spine right behind you.
Of
course you do.
So this is your spine.
Yeah.
All right. Sort of like a guitar.
Yeah,
so this is your spine. Yeah. And this is the lumbar spine. So the low back is right here.
Yeah.
This is L5, L4, L3, L2, L1. That makes up the low back. And between each of these bones, these are the vertebrae, between each bone is a disc. So the disc is a cushion between the bone that kind of keeps the bone separated. And importantly, it separates the bone so the nerves that come out on each side of the, on either side, are not going to get compressed. But if that disc herniates back or protrudes backwards into this opening that the nerve comes out of, well, naturally what happens is that nerve is going to get pinched and you're going to have compression on that nerve root. And if that nerve root is compressed, you get what's called sciatica. If you even have like spinal stenosis from being older, if there's arthritis in that area, that arthritis causes a narrowing of that canal and that nerve also gets compressed and you can get pain down into your leg. So if somebody's had surgery, like both Deborah and Jamie, what happens is, let's just say that surgery is done at L4-5, which is what Jamie said. I don't know where Deborah's was done.
It was L4, L5, and then the other one was like something with S1 or something. I can't.
Okay. Yeah. So the fusion, let's say that surgery was done at L4-5, which is this level. What happens is this level now is locked down. It's not supposed to move. And the idea is if it doesn't move, then you won't have pain is the theory. But what happens is when this level doesn't move at all, this L4-5 doesn't move at all, then what happens is all the force of the body, the weight of the body compressing down on the spine cannot, this level is rock solid now. So what happens is the pressure is taken on by another level, usually the level below or the level above. And if the pressure and the force is applied to the level below or above, what happens is that disc gets really worn out and you get more accelerated or more, you know, faster degeneration than would normally occur. And that's where people sometimes get bone-on-bone arthritis, where that disc gets completely worn away. Or on the back of the spine, very commonly what happens is these joints there are joints in the spine. These joints get worn away, and those joints cause very severe arthritis in the back, and that causes a problem that we can help also. Those are common stories in people who've had surgery. So you may do really well with surgery for a while, but a few years later, you might have trouble.
He's Dr. Sean Kondamuri. It goes like that. And we're talking about Midwest Interventional Interventional Spine Specialist, and they're in they're on Calumet in Munster. So we'll see him in a couple of weeks. Anything else, doctor?
No, I think we had a nice conversation about that. I mean, there are literally dozens of things we can do for the spine to help take away low back pain that are not considered big surgeries. And like you mentioned, the intracept procedure that I learned about just this week, that was something that is now a procedure that will help treat low back pain without actually cutting into somebody like you'd have for a big major fusion. And people will get relief.
All right, man. Thanks a lot. And we will talk to you soon. There it is. All right, guys. That's Midwest Interventional Spine. And we'll be back with him in a couple of weeks. And I will end that right now. And give me a sec.